So tell us your name and where you were born.
My name is Jeff Burnett. I was born in Wichita Falls, Texas.
And where did you go to school?
Moved right after I was born to Dallas, and that's basically where I grew up. I did my high school work at Brian Adams High School in Dallas.
And what is your role in the Pflugerville community today?
My role in the community is I have a dental practice that has been here for over 35 years, and that is my current role, is I come to work every day in Pflugerville. Okay.
What were you doing in 1965 when Pflugerville was born?
Well, in 65, I was intimately involved in fifth grade in Dallas, and was learning my way around. That was a new school for me in fifth grade, and I was learning my way around a new campus that we had in Dallas.
Where did you do your college work and then your that would be pre-dental and then dental school?
Sure, all my undergraduate work was done at the University of Texas here in Austin, and then I went back to Dallas to Baylor College of Dentistry in Dallas, and did all of that work there. And then as soon as I graduated from dental school, I moved down here to Pflugerville in 1979.
How did you determine Pflugerville was the destination?
That's an interesting question. I had another dentist that I knew who was practicing in Austin at the time, and he had multiples of patients that he had generated through a basketball coach, a women's basketball coach that was here at Pflugerville High School. A guy named Jerry English was a very good friend of his, and he started getting all sorts of folks to come to see Dr. Stafford. And so when I was about to graduate, Dr. Stafford asked me what I was doing when I graduated, and I said, well, I'm just kind of got open ears right now for anything that comes along in opportunity. And he said, well, you know, there's a little town outside of Austin, and I have some folks that come to visit with me, and we think that this little area has potential to grow. It's not very big right now, but we think that this might be a good time to come in and start getting roots in the community and to see if we can bring a service to the people of Pflugerville.
And so where did you... what was the location of your practice in Pflugerville?
We started out in a place that was called, at that point in time, was called Wood Creek Village, which was at the corner of Pecan and
Railroad.
Yeah, that's where it was. And we were, gosh, it was us and I think a hair and nail shop and the newspaper, the small newspaper that was going on. And there may have been something else, but there was not much going on. We sort of identified with the volunteer fire department across the street to tell people where we were.
Okay. So what was your impression of the town, the business folks that you met next door or within the town?
So wonderfully genuine was my first impression. Everybody was very friendly. It was different because I had come from Dallas, which was huge and fast and still growing in leaps and bounds and lots of traffic. And this was not quite that way back in 79. It was smaller, much smaller, but there was such a greater sense of community. Within that, I mean, everybody knew everybody, and I didn't know anybody, and so I thought, no, I can do this because these people are all so genuine, and they were really interested in me as an individual, let alone as in me as a dentist.
And obviously, you built those relationships. You lived in the community, were respected by the community, so eventually was elected to an office as...
I was elected to the Pflugerville ISD Board of Trustees and was immediately appointed secretary of the board in those early years. And so that was a wonderful opportunity. Frankly, besides agriculture, that was about the only industry in town at that point. And so it was a great outlet to learn more about the city and the community, because everyone loved high school football and girls basketball and all the things that the kids were involved with, and it was wonderful to see so much parental involvement in the kids' lives during their period in school?
As a trustee, one of the things that you did was to attend graduation or commencement exercises. Tell us what they were like in your period of service.
Well, that changed over the 15 years that I was on the board. We finally, in the early years, it was pretty easy to do it either at the field or in the gym if it was raining or somewhere like that, because we didn't have huge numbers of graduates. But before long, because we grew so incredibly fast, we had to pick another venue to get all our kids across the stage. So we began to go down to the University of Texas to the Drum and began graduating our classes there in that facility, because it was big enough for us to hold all of our graduates and the students and the families and the grandparents and all the others that supported those kids.
As the community grew and the subdivisions popped up, that meant the chore of building new schools. So tell us about your role again as a trustee in that process of selecting sites, working with architects, and opening the schools.
Great question. It didn't take us long in our growth pattern to realize we needed to shoot a little further ahead with picking sites for schools. The magic in that was trying to figure out where developers were going to be placing new developments ahead of time, because if we didn't, they would build them out and then there was no room in the development to have a school building. So it became pretty tricky to go in and we literally would drive around the district and count houses and count heads in houses to try to figure out what the numbers would mean for us as far as needing new buildings and new campuses. And so that became more and more of a challenge as we grew so rapidly. But we would go in and find where the centers of population would be developed and then try to pick a site as quickly as possible as we could to try to put usually an elementary school to feed that new development into, but not long after, new middle schools and then ultimately new high schools as well. So it was kind of a daunting task as fast as things were growing. There were several years where we were the fastest growing school district in the state of Texas, and that means a whole lot of building all at one time, following the construction along, seeing that it was going right. We had to hire people to come in and just run the construction aspect for the district, which we hadn't done before. Our superintendent at the time was so busy trying to watch construction and figure out curriculas and do budgets and do all of this that we grew too fast to be able to have him be able to do that all the time. So then the administration began to grow because we just didn't have a choice. One man couldn't be in eight places at one time. So that caused us to grow both administratively as well.
Your role as a trustee then, you also had oversight on the buildings and would do walkthroughs with your fellow board members.
We got to a point to where before we accepted a brand new building, we as a board would literally walk through. Even before that, we would accept an architectural plan that we felt like would work for us through a great system of architects that we had back then. And we would look at the plans and we would discuss that with the architect and the pros and cons of doing it this way or that way. And then once the school was built, then we would literally go in and walk the building. We would walk the halls and we'd look in the classrooms. We'd walk the kitchen and all the common areas. The gym and the kitchens, the cafeteria eating areas, the auditoriums, the stage, everything we could to look at it to see that it was in an acceptable condition for us to be able to make an approval on that, because we had to vote as a board whether we approved it or not. So we had to come in and look at it, and we wanted to see it. We wanted to see what was going on and the quality of the construction.
Again, in those early years, or in the 70s, in the fast growth, the dollar resources were somewhat limited. How, what was the challenge of funding the new growth that you might have encountered?
You know, we had to, each capital project had a bond issue that would come with that. Sometimes we had a bond issue just to buy property, buy sites at the time to do that with. And there was a few sites that we bought that ended up not being good sites because the development didn't actually go close enough to that location for it to be good. So we missed on a couple of those, not too many, but some that we did. And each time you had to build a building and buy sites, you had to float a bond issue. The school district didn't have the money to just go out and start paying cash for construction and real estate areas to build the schools on. So we had to vote bond issues through. Well, that's a challenge for a school district, and you had to make sure that the people, the taxpayers of the district, really understood the bond package. What were we really buying with this money that we were going to be asking the taxpayers to pay, and how could we make sure that we utilize that money specifically for the project that we told the taxpayers that would be going to. And so in order to get the trust of the community, we had to be very transparent with all of that, be very upfront with all of that, and make sure that everybody understood this goes to this building and nothing else. And so once we did that, we had to follow through with that. Otherwise, we would have not ever voted a bond issue again. You know, once you lose the taxpayers' trust, you're in trouble.
Another, I would imagine, a cost-saving initiative was you had, I would say, clones of buildings that you were able to replicate because you found that it was a good design and maybe just tweak that?
Exactly. We ended up, through several different designs, trying to figure out which one was going to be the best for us. And we were working with a company called SHW back then, which was our architect. And we found that we had one building that really suited our purposes at the elementary level very nicely. The district ended up saving lots of money because the same plan could be used for multiple elementary schools. And through the use of that plan, we kept having success with that. So we saved architectural fees by using the same plan. Obviously, we varied colors and patterns and tiles and this kind of thing. And it sort of depended on whether we built that out in the Pflugerville area or we crossed the line into Austin, because Austin had a different set of standards that we had to use to build in Austin versus what we would build out here. Even though the plan was the same, codes and other things made that change once you got into the city of Austin.
So were you on the board when Connolly High School was built?
I was on the board when Connolly.
That was our second high school. That was a big deal.
Yes, it was. It was kind of amazing. We found that property over there. It was in a really good location, but the amount of property was really tight. But we still were able to get everything on that we wanted to get on. It was a beautiful site. Nellie Connolly came when on the day we dedicated it. It was an awesome day, and that was a really neat school. But you know, that was the second high school for us, which was huge for this district, because when you go from one high school to a second high school, it really changes the dynamic of how things work and what do you do with your athletic facilities? Do you try to use a common facility? Do you have to build more stadiums? All these questions were kind of new territory for us, and we had to get through all of that as best as we could.
And that actually had been a dairy farm before it became the high school.
Yes, I'm not sure what all was on that property before. Besides the rabbits that were out there, there were a lot of guys that I talked to afterwards says, oh, we used to hunt dove on that property all the time. And I thought, wow, that was a while back, I guess. I'm sorry we took that away from you, but that's progress. So,
about your school board meetings, about what was the duration of a meeting?
Wow. When I first got on, we had some long meetings, and I don't know whether we just kind of couldn't get focused on to what we were really talking about, or some of those meetings went to 1 and 2 o'clock in the morning, and that sure made for a long next day at work, and we sort of over a few years of having the honor of serving on the board, I could just kind of tell there were certain things that we spent more time on, way more time on, than I felt like that we really needed should be spending. And we could have gotten to the end of that hunt a lot faster if we'd have just sort of focused a little bit better on what we were doing. Later on, those meetings got a lot shorter, and they were a lot more hospitable.
So any other issues on the school front that you recall either dealing with teachers or students or codes, dress codes, organizations, the multitude of...
You just hit a long list of things that were going on. Always you have every district that cares about what's going on evaluates their personnel. That's just part of the package of what we do. We wanted the most qualified, best individual to be a teacher that we could find. We didn't care where they came from. If they were here, awesome. If they came from Alaska, awesome. It didn't really matter. We just wanted the most qualified, most dedicated individual we could find. Well, over the years, sometimes, you know, that doesn't always hold. And so through the evaluation process, not often, but sometimes we'd have a teacher that would come up that we felt like was not able to carry the kind of standards that we were trying to hold them to, and you know, you have situations like that, and sometimes they just need to move along, and so as much as we hated doing that, the other side of that coin was now we have the opportunity to fill this position with something more that we're looking for. Okay, well, that happens from time to time. Obviously, discipline problems with kids come along. We had great principals at our campuses, and it was a rare day that we would come in and have a student issue actually that would come up from time to time because we had such great principals at our campuses, and so that's something that was, I'm not even sure we had maybe one or two of those, and perhaps an expulsion issue that came along, and then you know the county laws began to change, and if it was a real discipline problem, Gardner Betts was out there that we could send the kids to, that if they were really in a situation that was a more severe situation, we could always rely on some help from the county for some of those kids. But that was even a rare situation as well. So we were lucky to have not too many of those.
Were y'all recognized as an honor board during your period?
We were in the honor.
It's a huge thing.
Well, it was a huge thing, that was a really special time for us as a board. The honor board situation is every year the Texas Association of School Boards has a spring meeting, and I think it's in May sometime, and every year they have a kind of a contest called the Honor Board Contest, and boards out of the 1,000+ school districts in the state of Texas are able to come in and sort of enter the contest, if you will, about presenting their board as one of the best boards in Texas, and then the convention takes those boards and hones it down to one final board as is awarded the honor board of the state of Texas for that year, and it's the best board in the state. And so we were, I believe it was in 1996 that we were, our superintendent felt like we should enter that fray. We did, but gosh, we had so many school buildings we were building at that point in time. The board almost just didn't know how to prepare for something like that, didn't know what to do with something like that. So we were trying to get buildings built and have roofs over kids' heads, and our superintendent at the time, Mr. Spoonmore, was unbelievable in sort of putting the package together that would present us to the convention as a possibility. And there was this big, long series of steps we had to go through. The package had to be accepted, and then there was an interview process that we got honed down to, and then once we got into the interview contest part of that, then a board of superintendents were the judges for that, and I think we got down to five schools that were finalists, five school districts, and I remember that interview process with those with all those superintendents from great districts all the way around, and we were we were in high cotton, so to speak, to be with the other districts that were there. I mean, the Woodlands, I think, was there, and some Friendship was there, and districts that we had just been in total awe of because of their tremendous successes that they had had. And our interview went well. I think we were, our board was wonderfully engaged with the questions that they asked us, so we just felt like we'd already won because we'd made it to the top five, and we didn't expect anything after that whatsoever. So when we got on the stage they had all five boards on the stage in front of the entire convention. There must have been 2,000 or 3,000 people there at this convention at the George R. Brown Center in Houston, and they announced and it was us, and I was so shocked. I just thought, wait a minute, what about the Woodlands? What about these other guys? You know, and it was such an honor because our guys had worked so hard. They had done so much work and keeping their ears to the ground and realizing the importance of parental involvement with the kids in the school and it rallied everybody up. It was just a really neat thing. But we all knew as board members, there was no way that we would even be close to doing that if we didn't have an amazing administrative staff, including the superintendent. I mean, they're the ones that made it all possible for us. We just kind of showed up.
Well, the school has traditionally been the ambassador for the city because our students and, like in your case, the school board, the name Pflugerville has gotten out in the area and in the state in a very positive way. I'm going to go back to your practice for a moment. You eventually moved your practice then from the Wood Creek Village to a new present location. And tell us about that move and why you decided to move.
Well, we were growing with Pflugerville at the time, and our little location in Wood Creek Village was, I don't know if it was even 600 square feet. It was very, very small. I'll put it this way, people in the waiting room up at the front of the office could hear every one of my phone conversations in my private office while they sat there and listened. So you can see it was a small office, to say the least. And we had a restaurant that moved in next door to us in the Wood Creek Center. And the morning after old food aroma that was left every morning we walked in began to kind of get us a little bit. And I had been approached by someone who was building a new building up in our current location and said, you know, would you be interested at all in looking? I said, I'd be happy to look and see what it is. And they began to make a deal with us that was going to be suitable for us. So we ended up moving up to our current location up at 15300 FM 1825 in 1986, after we started in 79 here, and have been at that location ever since.
You've seen the practice of dentistry change over the decades, too. And I don't know that we want to go into that today, but thank you for your service to the citizens and the dental care. Lastly, are there any characters in the city that you would like to tell about? In other words, game changers or just interesting folks that you've met through the years, maybe business owners or whatever?
Yeah, I don't... I've always had a great relationship with the guys that were doing all the farming here in town, you know, and all the big families, the Weisses, the Bowles, the Pflugers, you know, all of them they've all been great folks for us to get to know, and we respected them and their heritage, you know, how they were brought up and how this place changed slowly but surely to really put us on the map from a very small, quaint German farming town to something that the growth is just splitting at the seams with. Even to this day, it has grown so fast and is still growing. I think one of the things that kind of put Pflugerville on the map was Deutschenfest years ago. You know, one of the first things that I got involved in when I got here, somebody said, well, are you going to do something with Deutschenfest? I said, I don't know what that is. And so once I started looking at it, it was just this great festival that was a local festival with a beauty pageant and a parade and all of this. And I mean, all I could relate to was the Cotton Bowl Parade in Dallas because that's where I was raised. And I think, well, maybe it's not quite that big. And so it turns out it wasn't, but it was just so much fun. So my first Deutschenfest, I said, you know, y'all put me where you need me. I want to volunteer to help with this thing. And so I got backstage with the electrician, and we were trying to figure out how to have enough plugs for enough hair dryers to all be running at the same time for the girls that were in the beauty pageant to be able to make that without blowing up the building. So that was so much fun. We managed to be able to get it all done and help the girls change the costumes. It was just a really awesome time. It's one of the funnest things I remember when I first got here was that first Deutschenfest for me.
So that's when they had the Miss Deutschenfest, and that was in the gymnasium on the Timmerman campus. It was a dome-shaped.
Exactly.
And they had celebrities from Austin to come out and do the emceeing, and I think they even had a swimsuit competition.
I know they had a talent competition. I know they had an evening dress competition. I don't remember if they had the swimsuit competition or not. I just don't recall that. It's just too long to remember.
Well, volunteerism has been a big thing in the community over the decades, and we can see that aspect in many ways, and one of which was the volunteer fire department, which you could see them across the street, I guess.
Absolutely. I mean, we would watch those guys. We could always tell when an alarm had gone off, not because there was a buzzer at the building. We could just see all the pickup trucks coming to the station, you know, in rapid succession, and knowing, oh, there's got to be a fire somewhere. And so they would go out and do their thing and take off. We'd hear the sirens, not that it was, you know, every 5 minutes, but we just knew that was something that was happening, and those guys, what a great service they did. I mean, they came from all over Pflugerville to come in and do the thing. And then, you know, not too long after that, the fire department had to grow because we were growing. It's always been great. It's a great bunch of guys.
What about eating places? Did you bring your lunch to work, or did you go out for a snack?
You know, there wasn't much going out for a snack in the local area back when I first got here. I think the only fast food place was the gas station that Norman Johnson had. In fast food back then was two pieces of bread and a piece of bologna slapped together by Mr. Johnson and given to you on a piece of wax paper. That was fast food. And then Knievel's was here. The barbecue place was here. But that was only one day a week on Fridays. You could get barbecue. So there just wasn't really much fast food. I think the first literal fast food place that came into town was probably the Golden Fried Chicken place that came up. And there were rumors, McDonald's is coming. McDonald's is coming, you know. And we went, okay, all right, let's see. And nothing would happen, you know. So in the meantime, I think after the Golden Chick came in, I think the Sonic came up after that. Sonic came in. Yeah, and that was on the outskirts of town, about 0.2 mile up toward 35. That was a big deal when Sonic opened up. But that was when Heather Wild, the development, had started growing, and there were people in there to do that with.
You still received mail at the post office near your office then to begin with?
Yeah, we had a post office box because that was the way mail came back then, was a P.O. box. And so I'd walk across the parking lot from my office at Wood Creek and walk over to the post office and go check my mail every few days and see what was going on with that. And then I think just about everybody got mail through the post office box. We didn't have a real house-to-house delivery system at that point in time when I first got here. That changed, of course, later on. But there were a lot of post office boxes, so that's how we did it.
So what do you see as the future for the community, or the city, the school, your office?
I think
5, 10, 50 years out.
Yeah. I might not be practicing 50 years from now, I think the city has done such a great job of realizing that growth is coming whether you like it or not. And that was one of the things early on. It seemed like, you know, we don't want to deal with this growth. Well, let's just act like we're kind of not here for a while, and maybe it'll go away, you know. And I had seen growth in Dallas come at an unbelievable pace, and I knew this was already starting to show little bitty signs of getting big. And I mean, obviously now when you go out to, you know, 130 and 45, that's the whole new center of Pflugerville, it seems like. It's coming whether you like it or not. And so I think that the response of the folks in Pflugerville now that realize that that's going to happen, and so we need to plan for that. And I think that we just need to understand that planning for growth is the right way to look at it, not thinking, well, I think it's going to go by us this time. I don't think that's the right way to approach it. And I think the city fathers, the city council, those guys have done a great job in trying to realize, yeah, we're going to have to provide services for people because there's more and more coming. We need to be able to keep up with water, with electrical, with all the things that has to come in. I mean, water in our drought, that's a big concern right now, you know, that we have enough water to go around to everybody. And so you know, people that are smarter than me, I'm sure, are planning for stuff like that. And I see Pflugerville just being, you know, I think it's going to be Austin, Pflugerville, Round Rock, Georgetown, and there will be no difference in there anywhere. There'll be no divisions in that like there have been in years past. It's just going to be all one thing. And so that's just coming. I think we'll practice. I've got years to go with my practice. I love it too much to walk away from it at this point in time. And I've had a lot of people ask me, are you going to retire soon? And I finally got a little, you know, a little concerned about that, because I finally asked somebody, I said, is it because I look like I need to retire from my practice? Is why you are asking me about to do that? And they know, no, we just know you've been here for a long time. And I said, you know, I'm not going to retire just yet. I've got maybe a good 10 years left to go. And if the Lord's willing and keeps my hands in good shape, then we're going to be good to go with that.
Well, thank you, Jeff, very much, particularly for your recap of stories, for your service to our school and education in the community, and for the health of our citizens.
Thanks, Verna Jean. My pleasure.